called by God to do something special for them. The people are just like us, just common, ordinary people. Moses was living on the backside of the desert and was revealed as the prince of Egypt, but God called him to deliver a nation. How about Mary? Mary was a teenage girl living in Nazareth when God called her to be the mother of Jesus. And Simon Peter would have lived in that ordinary fisherman, except that Jesus called him to establish the church. Do you see a pattern here? God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things. He uses common people who feel they have nothing to offer, but who use their faithfulness and willingness to say yes. So what has God called you to do? I'll tell you. It's something wonderful and extraordinary. He's calling you right now, and all you have to do is say yes, Lord. Please pray with me. Dear Lord and Father of all, thank you for bringing us together to praise and worship you. Thank you for seeing the extraordinary and ordinary lives and using us all to tell the story of you in wonderful words. Help us to say yes to you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open joy to be here to worship with all of you this morning. I get the privilege to introduce to you my pastor, woo-hoo! Pastor Brian Keepers. He comes to us from Trinity Reformed Church, where he has joined us in July, early August. His family moved here from Holland, Michigan. So will you please join me in giving him a warm Orange City Christian welcome.
You know, there are a lot of stories in the Bible that seem to tell us that, that God likes to take people who aren't perfect, who don't have it all together, but who maybe look more like this, with kind of some duct tape on the outside, things patched together, just pretty ordinary people, and he does really extraordinary things through them. You mentioned some of those stories this morning. I heard you, the young man who started us off this morning, talked about Moses, talked about Mary, talked about Peter. Can I tell you one of my favorite stories about how God used somebody who wasn't necessarily like this, but somebody who was looked like this? Can I tell you this story? I think you're going to know it. Maybe it's one of your favorites too. So again, I'm going to need some volunteers. I need Mr. Lamas first, okay? Let's give a clap for Mr. Lamas. The Old Testament book of 1st, okay? And here's how the story goes. God's people God had called, wanted to have a king. And so they chose a king. And does anybody know who they chose to be their king? How about right here? Joshua, that's a good guess. Somebody else, just call it out.
Saul.
And they chose Saul. You know why they chose Saul? Did Saul look more like this president or this president? This one, didn't he? I mean, he was handsome. He was strong. He was tall. Well, he had a really cool goatee. And everybody thought he would be the perfect king. But you know what? And this is the truth of Mr. Alonso. We're just pretending. He's pretending to be Saul. But on the inside, if you unwrap the package, there wasn't much in there. And there certainly wasn't a heart that really loved God and loved others. So God said to Saul that he's no longer going to be king, that God was going to choose a new king. And so God sent Samuel, I'll pretend to be Samuel, who was a prophet, and said, I want you to go to this little town called Bethlehem. Have you heard of that town?
Yeah.
Pretty ordinary town, actually. Maybe a lot like our city in many ways. And so I want you to go to the house of a guy named Jesse. So I need a dad to be Jesse. You guys are not as eager as the kids. You're not going to say anything. All right. Yeah, can you give this guy a little So Samuel traveled to Bethlehem, to the house of Jesse. And Jesse had 8 sons. Now we're going to do something, daughters, because we want to include both boys and girls. So I'm going to need 7. I need upperclassmen. We're living. Okay? So how about Shema. And Shema, too, was just, I mean, Shema was athletic, and Shema was talented, but was Shema going to be king?
No.
No. And he went down the line with each of the sons and the daughters, and God said, none of them is the next king. Now, how many sons did I say that Jesse had? Eight. Wait a minute. Eight? But how many can you see up here? Uh-oh. What's going on? We're missing one, aren't we? Yeah. So, listen up, okay? Listen up to this. This is my favorite part of the story. So Samuel said to Jesse, is this really all of the children that you have? And he said, no, there is one more, but this one's the youngest one. The smallest one, really not very extraordinary, nothing really special, probably one that maybe was more like this president. And Jesse said, there's no way that one could be the next king. In fact, he's out tending the sheep, doing a job that nobody else in their family likes to do. Think about a chore in your household that nobody wants to do, right? That's kind of what shepherding was like in those old days. So who's the little one here who is? So Jesse went, and Jesse brought the youngest. And the youngest was the smallest. Maybe not the strongest. But when Samuel saw the youngest, guess what God said? Yes. This is who's going to be the next king. Do you know what this one's name was? David, who would grow up to be the greatest king that Israel would ever know, a great songwriter and poet who writes a lot of psalms, like the Psalm 87 did. It was one of the psalms that's been important for us this month. A mighty warrior, a compassionate wise king. Now, help me with this. What did God see in David that we couldn't see? Anybody? Yeah. Yes. Very good. Here's what it says in 1 Samuel, if you read the Bible story yourself. It says, while we look at outward appearances, the outward wrapper, God looks beneath it into the heart. And God sees the heart. And what God saw in David was a heart that loved God, was a heart that wanted to serve God, was a heart that was available to be used by God. And that made all the difference. Hey, can you help me thank our helpers this morning? Take this. Give me 1 second. All right? What God cares most about, listen up, this is so important. God does not care most about what's on the outside of you. How tall you are, how short you are, what color your skin is, how smart you are, how athletic you are, how much money you have, the kind of clothes you wear. God does not care about all those things on the outside. But God looks what's inside the package. And what God sees is what's going on in your heart. And when you have a heart that says yes to God, when you have a heart that says, Lord, I want to trust you, I want to serve you, and I want to live with you, God takes us, just like he took David, our ordinary lives, and he does extraordinary things through us. And all of it is for the praise of his glory. Amen? Hey, can I pray for you? God, we thank you, as Psalm 87 declares, that you are a God who has done mighty deeds through your people, and that you have taught your people, ordinary people, to trust you with their hearts. Thank you for the story of David in a way that he didn't match what people expected a king to look like, but you saw his heart, and he had a heart that loved you and chased after you, a heart that loved others, and we want to have that kind of heart too. So Jesus, we pray that you would work in our hearts today. We offer our hearts to you. Lord, may you use us for your glory. And all God's children said,
Thank you. And the winner is...
Creation, I got to get it. So we arrived in Guatemala late at night.
Sunday, we got back late that night. We came home on Sunday. We got up a little bit later. I had a meal in the morning, and then in the morning, we did the same thing over again. We went to another coastal village. A lot more people that day. A lot more people. Again, we switch up the medical clinic so that everybody gets an opportunity to do that. And again, we're with the kids. At the end of the evening, we show them Jesus with me, fast preaches for them. And we share some testimonies, and we just have a really good time. I'm glorifying God. There's an altar call to do that. And we lay hands on those people. Thank you, sixth graders and first graders, Pastor, for your message and for leading us through this chapel. So great job. And let's close in prayer. We'll continue on. Our Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunity you've given to us to build your kingdom here. Lord, we thank you that you have called us, that you have called the people, that you have called us each individually, no matter what we look like or what blessings and gifts that you've given to us. But Lord, you ask us to be faithful. You ask us to do your will, to follow your commands, to be faithful as you are faithful. Help us to do that. Help us to have learned that this morning, and I'm looking for that out as we go through our day today and the rest of our week as we grow. Lord, thank you for all the ways that we can help. Lord, thank you for those that are celebrating blessings right now. Lord, we pray that you'll be with those who are hurting and need special support and attention. Lord, we pray that you'll help us to do that. You will provide and bring your peace and comfort, your love through us, so that we can build your kingdom here today. Go with us now in this day, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we had our wonderful competition yesterday where we brought in food and built some really, really cool structures. Parents, grandparents, I don't know if you were able to see some of those pictures on Facebook, but they did a great job. So, if we could have you all be winners, that would be awesome because you all did so well. So, thank you very much. It was really a blessing, and I think the food pantry would be blessed because of what we did. Well, we have one class that was chosen the winner, and then they will get to be able to deliver those food things through an AA ride. However, I was told by some girls this morning they really want to know the winner, so we're just going to dismiss. Well, it kind of seems fitting that the winner was coming. Thank you for your assistance in worshiping with us. You are dismissed.